Acknowledgements. With respect to those who died, and a warning to those alive. Dedicated to the 42nd and 45th U.S. Infantry Divisions, which liberated the Dachau concentration camp on April 29, 1945. Chapter 1. My Native Village. How do I remember events that occurred so many years ago? Once I realized that my memory has, to a great degree, reminded vividly and indelibly imprinted on my mind, I developed precocious talent for building a reservoir of events that happened in the past. For me, a survivor of the Auschwitz and Dachau concentration camps, to forget the horrific experiences endured in these camps is impossible. These experiences were more than enough to keep me awake at night for many years. I was born on May 19, 1924, in the small village of Polk, about 100 kilometers north of Warsaw, Poland. The village looked peaceful, and it seemed that time must have forgotten of its existence. It was an oasis of old-style community in the region of small farmers. Across the wide field, there were beautiful pine woods spreading on the flat countryside that stretched uninterruptedly northeast of Warsaw. There were many different people living in the village, including farmers, artisans, and schoolteachers. They all had dreams and aspirations the same as other people in the world. There was a 7th grade elementary public school that provided basic education for their children. Inside each classroom, there was a dark, brown, shiny crucifix on the front wall above the teacher's desk. The ground rules in the school were unquestioning obedience, orderliness, and hard work. In the village, Poles tended their fields and the Jews plied the trades along the unpaved streets of the village. Jewish cobblers, barrel makers, carpenters, tailors, and shoemakers earned their living in tidy family shops. People living in far-flung villages communicated either on foot or by getting letters in their mailbox. No one had a telephone, and visitors usually arrived unannounced. The Polish winters were long and severe. Sometimes when I woke up in the morning, I saw snowdrifts covering our one-story house up to the roof. Then there were the Polish hot summers and months of hard work in the fields. The religion of my parents and most of the people in the village could be summarized in two words. Polish Catholic. In many Catholic homes, there was the icon of the Holy Mary of Częstochowa displayed on the front wall. According to popular legend, in 1654, the Swedish army invading Poland was defeated and driven back at the gates of the monastery of Częstochowa, where an ancient picture of the Virgin Mary with a child was found, which had been revered for many centuries. This military victory was attributed to the power of the Lady of Częstochowa. At that time, she was given the title the Queen of Poland, and copies of the miracle-working picture were venerated in many Polish Catholic households. The devotion and admiration of the Holy Mary was visible everywhere. I remember when each summer on August 15th, my family and many people of the village would make an annual pilgrimage, about 20 kilometers, to the shrine of Our Lady of Skępe for the Feast of Assumption of the Virgin Mary. We marched along the country roads along the endless Polish plains. We passed fields of waving rye and wheat and tall, nodding sunflowers, singing religious hymns while the old ladies counted beads on their rosaries. Finally, the tip of the monastery spire would appear over the horizon. By dint of patience and pushing, we found ourselves in the chapel where the sacred image of the Holy Mary, encrusted by hundreds of burning candles and votive lamps, was visible. Before the Mass started, a satin-robed bishop would bestow his blessing on the pilgrims. Then he marched up and down the aisle, showering the crowd with holy water. During the Mass, the chapel resounded the songs of the Holy Mary of Skępe, the Hail Mary, and the Apostles' Creed, followed by a rousing chorus of God Save Poland. Here in this tiny, crowded place where the silence was broken by the murmurs of prayers, songs, and slow shuffling of pilgrims, you could see and feel the true heart of Poland. Chapter 2. The Winds of War, World War II, begins. On September 1939, Germany and the Soviet Union partitioned Poland almost equally between themselves and started to repress Poles immediately. German excesses in Poland were bloody and overt, while in the Soviet zone, the NKVD moved to eliminate the Polish military and cultural elite. On March 25, 1939, Hitler told Walter von Brauchitsch, German Field Marshal and Commander-in-Chief of the German Army, to consider the problem of Poland, further adding, "Poland should be totally subjected. This country shall not be taken into consideration as a political factor for decades." Dancing is not by any means the cause of the disagreement. The chief objective is to get for Germany in the East food and to control and safeguard new sources of foodstuffs. The question of Poland being spared, therefore, does not arise. After a series of provocations at the frontier, the German army invaded Polish territory at 4:54 a.m. on September 1, 1939, and World War II began. The Nazi Germany's invasion of Poland on September 1, 1939, started a titanic struggle that ultimately killed 50 million people and changed the world forever. By the time the slaughter ended, nearly 6 years later, more than 50 million people, two-thirds of them civilians, had been killed, shot, drowned, bombed, frozen, starved, or gassed. During the summer of 1939, all seemed peaceful in my village of Pollock, located about 25 kilometers south of the East Prussian border. Although life in my village continued its age-old course, the appearance of peace was an illusion. Every day for weeks, I saw passing Polish cavalry patrols being sent to the East Prussian border, and Polish refugees filtering across the border reported the growing strength of German forces on the other side of the border. They also brought ominous news of strong German tank formations and large-scale infantry and artillery movements. At the same time, German radio poured out lies and slander about Poland. On August 1, 1939, a squadron of Polish cavalry arrived at my village. They used farmers' barns as temporary quarters. For me and most of the people in the village, their presence provided some confidence that the Germans would not come. Unfortunately, the tranquility of my village and the country ended on the 1st of September 1939, when, without the slightest warning, the German army of 1.5 million men, led by 2,700 fast-moving panzers, tanks, struck along the 1,750 miles of Polish frontier. I was awakened at dawn in the morning of September 1, 1939, by roaring artillery from the front line. Overheard, I saw squadron after squadron of German aircraft flying like cranes toward Warsaw. On the first day, the German Air Force seized control of the skies. The Junkers Ju-87 Stuka dive bombers plunged down to blast road junctions and railroad lines. It had a device that emitted screams to spread terror among its victims. Then there were the heavy bombers flying squadron after squadron like cranes toward Warsaw. In surprise raids on the first gray morning of September, the German Luftwaffe wiped out all 500 airplanes of the Polish Air Force on the ground. The dawn surprise, the ramping panzers, the shrieking bombers, all were elements of the new German invention that was to change the nature of warfare. This was known as Blitzkrieg. The situation worsened as crowds of refugees with their belongings piled on all kinds of vehicles, and farmers with their cattle ahead of them had been blocking roads as they tried to escape the Germans. However, the crowds had no idea in which direction they should go. As this happened, hundreds of German aircraft bombed and machine-gunned the retreating columns of Polish soldiers. They even attacked small civilian groups escaping across the fields. As a result, bodies of many people were lying in the field and by the highway, among them those of children. On September 3rd, as the Polish soldiers were retreating, a German airplane circling around them ascended to the height of about 500 meters. As it dropped lower, it fired its machine gun on a small group of children being led by their teacher to the neighboring woods for shelter. The children scattered like sparrows. The airplane disappeared as quickly as it had come, but on the field, bright clothing and several bodies of the children remained. The next day, crowds of people were fleeing along the highway. Most of the vehicles they used were horse-drawn wagons. As the air raids continued, people sought safety in ditches, in bushes, in potato fields. But on the empty road, one could see only empty wagons. When the planes disappeared, one could see corpses of horses everywhere. Poor horses, big defenseless animals that did not know how to hide. They stood motionless, waiting for death. It was always the corpses of horses, black, bay, pied, chestnut, lying upside down with their legs pointing into the air and their hooves admonishing the world. It was always as if the war was not between people, but between.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.